Everybody who have organized conferences knows that it is very difficult to arrange the brain during the talks. So I appreciate this. So I'm going to speak about a simple subject, which is called matrix models. And first of all, why matrix models? Everybody knows that matrix models resurface again and again in theoretical studies. And there is a good reason for this. And basically, the reason is that matrix models is what remains from the quantum field theory, from entire string theory, after we eliminate everything related to space-time and propagation of particles. So if we think that anything remains after that, so what remains is exactly the subject of matrix model studies. So in this sense, we can say that the theory of matrix models is just the theory of pure interactions, so without propagation. So whatever we want to know about the interactions themselves, we can and should study at the level of this oversimplified theories. In other words, we can say that the story is about the possible vacua of the theory. So if we forget, one of the ways to forget about particles and propagation is just to take the lower energy limit of any given theory, then what remains are just the stable configurations, which we call vacua. And if we think that the pattern of vacua is non-trivial, and if we want to separate the study of vacua from everything else, we again end up with the study of this type of theories, like matrix models. Also, since this was the first talk at our conference here, I can mention that this is exactly the context or the arena in which the landscape theory is it should be formulated and studied. So we want to, if we want to know how different physical quantities are distributed in the spaces of possible vacua, thus again we should try to formulate all the quantities in terms of the physical quantities in terms of this vacua variables, so again in terms of matrix model kind of variables. So this is one way to reason for the study of matrix models. Another thing which is also very important is that matrix models are the example of quantum field theory which are as solvable as one can only imagine. So if we ever think that we can in one or another sense solve a problem, we can certainly do this at this matrix model level. And the concept of solvability is a sophisticated thing, and let me not go into details about what it means. Certainly the notion of integrability is part of solvability, but that's not quite the same story. Anyhow, we hardly will ever meet any other example of quantum field theory which would be a better problem. And thus, if we have such a theory under hands, we naturally arrive at the question of if we can solve it really. So what do we mean, and what kind of questions we want to address at all? And this is of course a basic question for the whole theoretical physics and for the whole string theory. What can we produce except of just words about these theories? Since I cannot assume that too many people here are familiar with the subject, let me start from reminding you just some very simple things about what a matrix model is. Before enumerating these things, but which we can try to get them. So the story is just about taking an integral of the usual type, so just for historical reasons, from often called the action in this situation, W not S, but and also the time constant is normally denoted by G. There will be some reasons for this. And what distinguishes matrix model is that the field here, which is denoted by M, is a matrix. So it doesn't depend on any space-time coordinates. The integral is just finite dimensional. It is N by N matrix. And we want just to study this N by N, N squared model integral. And so the first thing which comes to our mind usually when we see quantum field theory, and this is certainly an example of quantum field theory in the functional integral formalism. So what we usually do? We try to calculate correlation functions. So this, in this context, this means that we want to calculate the correlators of this type. Now, in just this particular oversimplified example of so-called eigenvalue matrix model, so the reasonable correlation functions contain just traces of the powers of matrices. That's not a very important restriction, but still it is useful to do it. And in this eigenvalue type of models, we can just easily convert this n squared fold integral into an n fold integral over eigenvalues of the matrix n. It appears that we can diagonalize the matrix, so switch to the eigenvalues, which are called mu I here. And it will be possible to integrate explicitly over the unitary matrices which bring the matrix to diagonal form. And the only thing which this integral over unitary matrices will produce will be a kind of a Jacobian, which has this sort of graded form of Vandermonde determinant, which has two different representations, one in terms of a product and another in form of determinant. And many concrete techniques related to matrix models heavily use this technical property. But in principle, it is not extremely important to you. So, so first we want to calculate these correlation functions. And second, of course, our extreme dream in the usual quantum field theory would be to calculate not just the correlation functions, but to form a generating functional, which is just which generates all these correlation functions at once. So, to in order to get a generating function, we, as usual, just add the things which we want to get in the correlators as additional terms to the action, with some sources which are denoted dk here, and for some reason are usually called time variables in the case of matrix models. So the generating function will be this this quantity, this integral, and it depends on infinitely many parameters tau k. And I repeat once again that while in generic the quantum field theory, we can at most dream about knowing something about such quantities. In matrix models, this will not be a problem. We can tell a lot about these things, and then we can, looking at this information, we can try to understand whether it was really a good idea to search for correlation functions and to search for generating functions, and to understand what kind of information we get from this, what kind of information will still be lacking. So already now we can notice that though our motivation was to introduce these time variables to generate all the correlation functions, of course the whole quantity depends on many other additional variables, the enumerated here. And of this, very important in particular and is the integration contour. Which says how exactly we are going to integrate to take the integral in the in our functional integral. So to make things a little more concrete, just we can start from the simple situation which we usually consider in giving We can start from the Gaussian action W. Then we can certainly calculate everything developed by perturbation theory as we usually do, and we can see what will happen. So in this Gaussian case, all the correlators can be, of course, explicitly evaluated. So we have a single point correlator, just a single point to the power k. So for example, if it was m to the power 6, so this would be a vertex with 6 external lines. Since these are matrices, the lines are doubled as usually. And we can contract all possible, contract these n's in all possible ways. Because this is a Gaussian integral, so the contraction, the propagator is dictated by this action W. And so then we will get an answer which basically looks as follows. So every propagator contributes to us a factor of G, and every loop here contributes a factor of N. Then a simple examination of this graph shows us that we will have the same power of G for the whole diagram, but the powers of N will be different depending on the ways and how we contract the lattice. For example, if we neglected this blue piece, so if it was M4th vertex, we would have this green diagram, which would have one circle, another circle, and a big circle around. So it will be N to the power of Q. Yeah? So this equal contract these 6 lines, not in the way as it is drawn here, but in this way and in this way, will have n to the power 4. So the term of this kind. But as it is seen in this picture, there is another possibility to contract them in this way in the picture, and then the power of n will be different. And so in general, we will have different terms in this expansion. And these are the coefficients A, B, and so on, the just numerical coefficients, which we want to calculate and which characterize for us this simple correlation function. So this, these letters have a special name. They are called Catalan numbers or generalized Catalan numbers, and so they are known since 16th century, I think. But what we know today is, or what we prefer to do today, we want to form from them a generating function, just like I mentioned. Since in 16th century, they were not studying quantum field theory, they didn't form this correlation function sometimes. And also only could. And so the simplest example of this correlation function is associated with the single point diagrams, according to this expansion, will be, so there will be infinitely many terms of this type. And what we can see is that G and N can be unified in a single, in this leading term, in a single quantity, Gn. So one N can be taken outside, just as a general normalization. And it's not a big surprise that the, that the leading terms are given by the function of the product Gn. And exactly the formula is like this. So the terms of the second type will be collected in another piece, so there are more G's than N's. Yeah? So the next term on this expansion will give us something like this, and so on and so forth. So this is an example of what I mentioned, that the problem is solvable, so you can you can generate whatever you like.
Is this the partition function or just a general?
It is not. It is the generic function for this particular correlator. Yeah.
Well,
so
there is an S and there is a Z.
So no, Z is small Z. Sorry, there was a big Z for partition function, and this is just an auxiliary variable which appears in the generic function. But yeah, that's an ancient question. But unfortunately, it was not me who introduced all the notations, and so we should leave with the other question there. Whenever there is nothing can be done, whenever. So what is the main lesson from this very simple story? The main lesson is that we started from just introducing this innocent variable, Z, and we end up with an obvious observation that this letter usually enters in some strange combinations, so with the square roots of this particular form. In putting this in beautiful words, we can say that we observe that this parameter Z is in fact living on a non-trivial Riemann surface, which is going to be called a spectral surface. So we reveal, just in this absolutely simple example, we reveal a very deep hidden structure, a hidden which we couldn't think about at the very beginning. That this parameter Z in fact belongs to some thing which was not obvious from the very beginning. So what is the meaning of the Z? No, the Z appears just in this formula, so if I sum up this series over Z, I can write this in a form of such quantity. And in some intuitive sense, you can think that Z parameterizes for us something like vacuum expectation of this matrix M, of this field M. So what we really observe in this example is that the what we would like to call vacuum expectation values for our field, in fact, live on a trivial spectral surface. And this, we already know that this something like this is happening in many examples of real quantum field theory, but this is the simplest place where it appears and where you can try to formulate exactly what it means. And, that's not that I'm going to formulate it exactly, because nobody did it. But this is a very clear and appealing question. So the second thing, which is very well known and which is reflected by this formulas, is that in fact the correlation functions are nicely expanded not just in powers of this variables like g. They are better expanded in the form of this Hopf expansion in parameter gn, which is special. And let me remind you that a very important fact about this Hopf expansion, a very important thing about collecting the terms in this special way, is that the whole series of correlation theory, the whole series, the whole generating function for all correlations, correlated and so on, all these quantities are expected to be divergent in quantum field theory, just for the reason that we are trying to expand potential of high degree using as a zero approximation the quadratic form. So it is obvious that the series which you get in this way are divergent. But in fact, it is also well known that divergency appears when we try to sum up all these terms. Every particular combination, so every sum of diagrams with a given genus, is given by a convergent series, and here it is just a clear manifestation of this fact. So every particular term is just very well defined. It's a nice analytical function. It is an analytical function on a non-trivial and maybe not quite expected a priori spectral surface, but it is certainly a convergent quantity, well-defined quantity. So the third thing which should be mentioned at this simplest level is that, of course, you can calculate not only only this correlation function, but also whatever else you like. For example, you can calculate a two-point function of this type, so it is a generating function for all correlators of the form trace m to the power k1 trace m to the power k2. So this thing can be also calculated, the answer in this leading order, so it will be again expansion in powers of g squared, but already the leading term is extremely interesting. So it is given by this terrible expression. But in fact, every everybody who knows the calculus on Riemann surfaces immediately recognizes that this is a very important quantity. In general, it can be written in this form in terms of some prime B differential, but that's not so much important. What is important is that this is a correlation function, of two free fields on a Riemann surface. That means, so if we take a Gaussian integral over fields on a Riemann surface, in this case, this is this auxiliary spectral surface. So the correlator of two functions of two free fields on a Riemann surface would be exactly given by this formula. This opens a non-trivial possibility, non-trivial idea, gives a non-trivial idea that for some reason this generating functions of correlators in our original theory, our original model, for some reason can be interpreted, just these generating functions can be interpreted as correlators in some other theory. Once again, these are generating functions of correlators, and they are just simple correlators in just in an absolutely different in some conformal field theory associated with the spectral surface. That's only one of the interesting possibilities. Another possibility, which we'll discuss probably later, is to formulate this whole thing in a quite a different form, in a form which resembles, or in fact is an example of string field theory, where the same quantities rho will not be correlators of something, they will be fields of some other theory, the generating functions of this correlators in our original model. And this, in particular, is a very big and important story. Just this is the essence of the string field theory indeed. So it is exactly an illustration of how we expect anything in our world to be embedded into a string theory. So if we start from any model blank, just in this case from this oversimplified model, but still some kind of functional integral, we expect that in this theory we will find the generating functions which are in fact solutions to the string field equations of motion. So there is some underground phi cube theory, specific phi cube theory, and in which our correlators or the generating functions are just solutions of those phi cube equations of motion. And again, in the case of matrix models, this will be an absolutely explicit statement, which probably I'll show you. And the third small remark about this formula is that, though, as I said, this thing is a correlator of two free fields on a Riemann surface, that's not quite true. This thing doesn't have a pole at coincident points, as it is obvious from its definition. There is nothing special happening when that one is equal to zero. In fact, what happens is that it is a correlator of two fields, but taken at two strange points. So this spectral surface has an additional structure. It is a hyperelliptic surface which has two sheets. And in fact, the correlator which appears here is a correlator of a field which lives on one sheet with a field which lives on another one. And that's again a very non-trivial story, and I just mentioned it here, but it leads to a very important issue of the quantum field theories, which are defined in such a way that they don't have physical poles in the propagators. And this story has many interesting combinations. So after reminding you about this simple example of Gaussian model, let me return to the question which I asked at the beginning. So, what kind of questions we can address if we have under hands a field theory which we can solve in some sense? So, as I said, of course, the first question to address is to calculate correlation functions and calculate generating functions. And already in the simple example of Gaussian case, we already know what we should expect. We should expect that there will arise these hidden spectral surfaces, and Based on this, we will manage to introduce at least two absolutely different kind of representations in terms of conformal field theories and in terms of mean field theory. And we can check that this will really happen, at least at the level of matrix models, if we remove this restriction that we consider a Gaussian example. So the model is equally well studyable not only at Gaussian point, but everywhere else. And all the same will happen there, of course. The next question to ask is what will be the real current structure of this theory? So we have the original model, and we can ask on which additional parameters is that this time big Z of t is going to depend. So I enumerated for you just some obvious quantities, but in fact the story will be more sophisticated. So there will be a whole hierarchy of levels in the space structure. In fact, it appears to be surprisingly rich, and even today we don't know anything about the really general phase structure of the matrix model. We know what happens if we impose this additional requirement that Janus expansion exists. It is by no means a general phase for the matrix model, just as the Hopf expansion or 1 over n expansion is not a general story about Young-Hinz. There are plenty of different other phases, and of course the same will happen here. But even if we impose this Janus expansion requirement, then there will be still a hierarchy of phases which will depend on the choice of this original potential, which cannot be only Gaussian but anything else. And moreover, it appears that even after that, there will still be different phases parameterized by some additional function f. And this is the story which these days is known under the name of the graph alpha theory. And it deserves special story. Another thing which we can ask if we know explicitly how to solve the model, we can ask the question about dualities. So this is the question of whether we can find differently looking models which are in fact the same in the sense that they produce the same partition functions. Also, as soon as we realize that the phase structure is sophisticated, it is getting clear that the original question about relation functions should be supplemented by additional question. So if there are infinitely many different phases, it doesn't make too much sense to calculate correlation functions in one of them. So I repeat that this is what we usually do in quantum field theory. There's a big success if in a single phase in a quantum field theory we manage to calculate at least some correlation functions. But we should clearly realize that even if we do this, we know a very small piece of the theory. And in different phases, we'll have absolutely different correlation functions. The real question, even if we are interested in them, is to find some kind of universal formulas which describe correlation functions just in any particular phase. In other words, we need formulas which represent our correlators as a kind of operators acting in the space of different vectors. So really the correlation functions are operators acting on the space of vectors, and in fact, again in the solvable model, we can explicitly explain what it means. We can explicitly write this operator generalizations of those formulas which I wrote you for this letter row. But it appears that in order to really study this and understand all this, we need a deep rethinking of what the partition function really is. So, as you know, usually we don't have a minor chance to calculate our correlation functions, especially in all phases and so on and so forth. And in fact, the reason for this is deeply related to the fact that we are trying to look at the correlation functions as results of functional integration. In fact, when doing this, Now, of course, we know that that we are doing this inaccurate thing, but we don't pay enough attention to this. So when we are doing functional integrals, we usually don't think much about contours of integration. And this is the origin of all our problems, of all our non-perturbative effects, so to call, and so on and so forth. And we don't have a very good understanding of what the functional integral really is. When we manage to calculate it in one way or another, we immediately discover that we should add contributions of an absolutely different type, like instantons, monopoles, and so on and so forth, which were neglected in our original formulation. So in some sense, what happens is that what we really need, we need to consider all possible integration contours in our functional integrals, and we need a way to understand that how we are going to combine all these different contributions together. And there is a general way to describe and solve this problem. This is to redefine our partition function not as an integral, but as a solution to some equation, yeah? Schrödinger-Dyson equation, as we call it in physics, or Carl-Fuchs equation, as we call it in mathematics, or whatever else. The modern day word is just to say that this is a D-module, so just a partition function is a whole entity, a whole collection of all solutions to some defining equation. And then our original thing is nothing but an integral representation of this solution. And integral representation usually describes for us only one particular branch of this whole function. So the real partition function is a multi-branch or multi-phase in physics quantity. And this is exactly what we keep in mind when we are speaking about string theory as a theory of everything. We believe, in some sense, that this multi-branch and multi-phase partition function, which we would call the partition function of string theory, contains as its particular branches just everything we can imagine. So in some limits from this general unified quantity, we probably will manage to reproduce in some corner any other particular model which we keep in mind. So if we substitute the whole string theory by a small piece of matrix models, and matrix models, everybody who worked with them clearly understands that this is just exactly the string theory, only with some a lot of complications thrown away. Just all the ideas are present. Whatever non-trivial thing you are expected to see in generic string theory, you will immediately find in matrix models. Just exactly because in string theory we are not very interested in the stories about propagation of particles, about retarding interior directions, and so on. All these things are for us trivial in string studies, so we think that we already learned them. At the example of quantum electrodynamics. And then all the interesting things which remain, as I explained, will be seen at the level of matrix models. And of course, this is what happens in this particular story also. So the equation which defines this generic partition function is known under the name of Virasoro constraints, or loop equations in the field of matrix models, and it can be written in many different ways. So it is Virasoro constraint, but Virasoro algebra, which appears here, is of a special form. It is just the stress tensor, two-dimensional stress tensor, built as a square of a current. So there is this additional structure that the Virasoro constraint is in fact a square of of some current. And then this fact can be used in many different ways. So in some sense, we have the partition function defined as a solution to this type of equation. This depicts that this case, yeah. And there are plenty of ways in which we can look at this equation. Just to mention two trivial possibilities associated with this conformal field and string field theory representations, we can try to build up some Hilbert space and find a vacuum in it which is annihilated by this operator T, and this is the robot which leads to this conformal field theory representations. And instead we can notice that this T is D squared, and then we can, instead of this, look for some other action for which the equation j squared equals zero would be equation of motion. So we can try to solve this kind of equation, and not surprisingly, this will keep for us an action which is j cubed. And this is not just a funny observation. This is quite a big thing, and this is exactly the reason why this string field theory action will be phi cubed. Only you should be much more careful, and this is not just j squared, this is just minus part of j squared, and so on and so forth. Because of this, this interaction is quite sophisticated. It is ultra-local, just as phi cube interaction should be in string theory, and so on. I have a transparency about this, but certainly I don't counter it. Just one more thing to mention in this general list. is that if we finally introduce this partition function, we will surprisingly discover that this very simple quantity can in fact be split into even more simple quantities. So there is a kind of decomposition formulas. So our partition function is in fact a product of many even more elementary partition functions. And they are grouped together by a kind of a model skewing operator, which lets use our models together. And in this sense, it appears that there is additional hidden structure. There is a kind of elementary building blocks from which, from combining which, you can build your partition function in all possible phases. So this sophisticated quantity, its complicated branch structure, can be instead described as a possibility to combine the elementary building blocks in different ways by introducing different products, different skewing operators, and so on. You can reformulate your original complicated structure in terms of different skewing procedures. And this has a lot of philosophical and practical implications. Should I finish? Just maybe since I came to this decomposition formulas, maybe let me show you the picture which has to do with that. The picture is of course absolutely obvious, but also very mysterious. So this picture shows a typical W, so the typical potential. And I should emphasize that there are almost two different ways in which you should look at matrix models. You can consider it as an example of functional integral. Then just generalization will be that this W, this M is usually in ordinary quantum field theory. It also depends on space-time variables, so it is an absolutely huge space of this M's. This W then depends also on derivatives of this M over space-time coordinates and so on. And this is one way to look at this. And another way is just to look at the matrix model as an example of a set of many different models. So imagine that the structure of any other model and its place in the whole entity would be exactly the same as of this one. And when I was showing you this decomposition formula before, I was standing on the second point of view, and I was trying to say that any model is in fact can be constructed from some elementary building blocks. But looking at this picture, it will be sometimes also useful to look at it as an example of functional integral. So if it was just integral, it is clear that some special role would be played by this extrema of this action W. Okay? I emphasize the word extrema because if we would really look at it as a physical theory, of course we would like to look at minima. Yeah? But if we really keep in mind a generalization to arbitrary quantum field theory, then we perfectly understand that this is incorrect, that all extrema play a role, actually. So, because in different phases arises when you start to change the shape of W. Yeah? So then if we change the shape of W, the thing which was a maximum in, for one W can become a minimum for another. And if we really want to have a universal formula which works for all possible W's, then whatever we can think about, I don't know, quasi-classical approximation or so on, should take into account all the potential extrema of the story. Yeah. And this is very important.
I think that's true in classical.
Of course,
that the maximal, the extrema are the important things of the action. And you can find it in classical examples where,
yeah, of course,
where
of course,
physics sits at the
So if it is obvious, this is obvious, yeah, but just So at the first level of decomposition formulas, it is absolutely clear that you can think about representation of this type. So if you take logarithms of this, this will be just a sum over extrema. Yeah? So this is just an example of what we call instanton gas picture in quantum field theory. Yeah? So this kind of decomposition formula. The only correction is that you can make these formulas exact. So it is not just a particular contribution of instanton, it's a whole perturbation theory built over it. And then you rather deal not with sums but with problems. That's also an important lesson. The nature operators will act on the problems. But what is even more non-trivial, it appears that this is not the end. In fact, the real formula is so this at this level of course it also exists, but the real thing is this is this product formula, which is a product over all these crosses here, whatever they mean. And you see that what really happens is that every extrema can be split into pieces. In the instanton picture, this has a counterpart, this halves of instantons, the splitting of instantons, are known as merons. And today we know for sure that they are really the things which are responsible for confinement, just from these experiments. Thank you.
Starting from the differential equation. Can you finally give a meaning to supersymmetric version of matrix model? Is that possible?
I think you can, but that's not really the point of my interest. I don't know much about supersymmetric generalizations and matrix models. So nothing clever. I think yes. I don't see any big problem with this.
There was a big problem with some normal theorem Hermitian superanalysis.
No, we should be precise on what the problem is, and don't look at this kind of thing.
Are you implying that already the phases and phase systems and transitions and so on in quantum field theory should be described by matrix models or not?
In a sense, yes, that's also true. No, of course, again, it depends on what it means to describe. Yeah? Of course, matrix models do not provide you exact answers for everything. Yeah? If you neglected something, you neglected something. That's unavoidable. What they give to you, they give an oversimplified picture of what is happening, which captures the main problems which exist in the theory of phase transitions. The main problem in the theory of phase transitions, there are many different basic problems, just to understand the whole pattern is the main problem. And just to give you one example, we usually think of phase transitions as of some things which are just particular points in the phase space. Yeah, in a sense. For us, they're quite rare. We know that there is water and vapor, yeah, and the whole range of temperatures and everything else where there is nothing interesting happening at this point of view. In fact, this is absolutely incorrect. So as we know from the theory of dynamical systems, from the theory of, not just to remind you some words, Mantel-Brod varieties and this kind of things, you know that in fact the phase transitions tend, though they are high codimension happenings, in fact they tend to condense. Just if you remember the Mantel-Brod set, which is just, you remember such a figure of a complicated fractal structure, but what is important, it has codimension 1. While every particular phase transition had codimension 2. just particular transition responsible for restructuring of the phase diagram has codimension 2. But the whole picture combines in a codimension one thing, so that you can never get just from one place to another without crossing some phase transition. That's just an example of things which we usually overlook studying the phase transition phenomena. They will play much more important role than we usually think in our understanding of the future. There will be if we really want to unify everything, we should be prepared to the fact that there will be no ways around in particular. And matrix models is one particular possibility to start looking at all these kind of problems. Of course, after we understand the pattern, we can ask the questions of dressing, how it just exactly the existence of particles modify, smoothen, or whatever else they do, the phase transitions, and this is not captured by matrix models. But there is more fundamental structure, which is usually inert, which should be studied, and which can be studied in this way.
First part, you mentioned this Gaussian matrix model as string field theory, you know, on the spectral curve. This specific example of Mandelson, Moore, Steinberg, and Shi, is that one example of that, or you have something else in
mind? Yeah, I think it is one of the examples. Though I want to emphasize that Gaussian model is just one particular phase. The string theory is this whole collection of W's, and moreover, the whole collection of the scaling factors and so on. So this is what models string theory. So the whole variety of phases is described not Gaussian point, it's just a single point of the whole story. But they can be. But in fact, what happens is that the theory of Gaussian models appear in some sense exhaustive. That I mentioned for you the general formulas which produce correlation functions in all possible phases, and it appears that being properly reformulated, they are exactly the same as the Gaussian models. Only some operators should be introduced in places of functions, but that's a separate story. But I think that particular example is an example. Yeah.
Other questions? Remarks? Not less than